vertical plate case, where how the temperature profile and how the velocity profile will be varying. And then we moved on to the equation, and we felt that we could discuss that the momentum equation is the only thing that gets changed in the that gets modified in the natural convection process. Apart from the momentum equations, we don't have any change in the continuity nor the energy equation. In both of them, we don't find any changes, but essentially we have a change in the momentum equation. This is because there is an external buoyancy force which is acting. In the forced convection, we also figured out what are the basic differences between the driving forces in natural convection as well as forced convection. In forced convection case, we do have a pressure force which is actually driving the force. But the pressure is being built up because of the fan or blower, and only that part will be introduced into the force term. But as here, apart from the pressure that is created because of the force, so we have to include that particular external body term, a body force term, which is the net force. Which actually puts or drives the flow, vertical flow. So, which actually drives the flow in the vertical direction or in the upward direction. So we figured it out how to implement that into this equation, and using a Bosinesq approximation. Initially, when we are deriving the all the equations, we tend to take the properties to be function as a constant. Similar assumption we have made here, but only thing is, instead of density, we have taken the temperature density difference as a constant, and the density difference we are trying to measure it with the help of a Bosinesq approximation, and from that you found out the x momentum equation. And similarly, when you apply this x momentum equation away from the hot plate where the effect is not being felt, that equation if you use will be ending it up with a final set of final solutions like this continuity momentum and energy. Similarly, in the y momentum equation will become nothing but dou p by dou y equal to zero. So only in this particular case where x direction is showing the negative gravity direction, the opposite direction to gravity, so positive x will be in the upward direction we have taken. So considering that coordinate system, we are actually defining the x momentum equation in that, and y momentum equation will be dou p by dou y equal to zero. Apart from that, the energy equation and momentum and continuity will remain the same. But the important point that we need to look at in this momentum equation is there is a temperature term which we need to actually find out at every point. So all these three equations has to be simultaneously solved along with their boundary conditions. That's the importance of this. And then we have moved upon to the Kirchhoff number. So when we non-dimensionalize these equations, we have got a new term, non-dimensional term, which is nothing but the its ratio of viscous forces to the buoyancy force to the viscous force, which is called as the Kirchhoff number. And we also discussed what is the importance of the Kirchhoff number. We felt when we understood that the Kirchhoff number is used actually as a benchmark where to tell us when the natural convection flow becomes transforms from laminar to turbulent. So in a vertical hot plate condition, we will generally consider it to be 10^9. So above 10^9, we tend to think that the flow is turbulent, and below 10^9 again it is laminar. Apart from this, we always have, whenever there is a forced convection case, there are instances where forced convection is also accompanied by free convection, and we tend to neglect the free convection effects, thinking that everything is in the forced convection. But generally, the buoyancy forces may also be accompanied with the forced convection because of the temperature gradient, higher temperature gradient. So, in order to understand when the forced convection is dominant, when the natural convection is dominant, and when we should take the combined effect of these two, which is called as the mixed condition. So mixed convection we call it as. So those three conditions, in order to differentiate those three also, we require the Kirchhoff term. And then we defined another term called Richardson number. It is called as Richardson number, which is defined as the Kirchhoff number by Reynolds number square. So when the Kirchhoff by Reynolds number square is pretty much less than 1, when the Richardson number remains in between 0 to 1, 0.5, 0.6, that range, 0.1 to 0.68, up to that range. If it remains, we always neglect the natural convection effects. We only consider that to be forced convection. Whereas when the Richardson number is greater than 1, very much greater than 1, 1.5, 2, 2.58, 7, those numbers greater than 1, very much greater than 1, in those cases, we tend to neglect the forced convection effects. We only consider the natural convection effects in such a case. But whenever there is the Richardson number comes approximately becomes equal to 0.98 or 1.1, 1.2, when it becomes in that range, we generally we call it as a mixed convection case, where we need to consider both the effects. Both forced convection we have to simultaneously add to the natural convection case. So that also we have seen yesterday. So a figure which actually shows this also has been shown in the yesterday's figure, so that you can remember that very easily. And then what are the, even though we have we understood the natural convection physics and all, due to the complexities in the flow because of the surfaces and all, we generally even though we have some analytical solution, but their generality is not the same for all the surfaces. So mostly we depend on natural convection, we depend on the experimental correlations that we have got. So the experimental correlations, we started with Nusselt number in a generalized form. We have written like a constant C into Rayleigh number whole power n, where C is the constant, coefficient constant we call it as, and then power whole power n, which is actually called as constant exponent. So constant exponent, it depends mostly on the flow regimes. For a laminar flow, it is 1/4, and for a turbulent flow, it becomes 1/3. And C generally depends on the geometry of the surface. And the properties that we use to find out the Rayleigh number, in order to estimate the Rayleigh number, we always take the film temperature, which is Ts plus T infinity by 2. So once we figure out what is the heat transfer coefficient, then we will use it in the convection heat transfer coefficient equation, and then we will solve that. We will use it to evaluate the heat transfer rate. So for different cases, for different orientations, we have given the table 9.1 in that. These are giving the empirical correlations which we can use for the three different configurations: flat plate, cylinder, and sphere, and at different orientations, when it is flat, when it is vertical, and when it is in the inclined position. So when can we use what equations we should be knowing in this particular thing? So we started with a vertical plate, and the vertical plate whose surface is maintained at an isothermal temperature, that is everywhere along the surface, the temperature remains constant, which is taken as Ts, which is greater than T infinity. In such a case, we have three correlations. You can see that 9.19, 9.20, and 9.21. There are three different cases we can use for that, and we can solve those equations. So the first two equations are 9.19 equation, if you see, that is for laminar range, and 9.20 equation, that is for a turbulent range. Apart from these two, there is another important expression which can be used over a wide range of these Rayleigh numbers. It's basically can be applied all throughout the ranges of Rayleigh number, which is popular and mostly more accurate, but a little complex in calculations and all. So we have three equations, and mostly we use the 9.21 equation for finding it out. And the second case in a vertical plate consideration is that we also have another boundary condition where we are supplying a constant heat flux. In that constant heat flux case, what we can observe is the temperature of the surface will not remain constant, it will be varying. So in such a scenario, what equation we have to use? So experimentalists, after doing a lot of experiments, they found out that it is not much different from the Nusselt number correlation, which is used for constant temperature plate, except that throughout there is a temperature difference. And they determined that if you can take the temperature at the midpoint as the temperature of the surface, then you can directly use the table 9.21 equation for evaluating the Nusselt number for constant heat flux boundary condition also. So I'm repeating again, for a constant heat flux boundary condition plate, If we can take the center, I mean, that means L by 2, the length of the plate is taken as L, which is in the vertical direction. If at the center L by 2 distance, if I can take the temperature as the surface temperature, then I can safely use that temperature surface into the equation 9.21 and I can solve the Nusselt number equation. And then what if it is a vertical cylinder, that is, yeah. Heat flux is specified, correct, but if only okay, then I'll find it out. Only heat flux if it is given. Now for any heat flux condition we need to know the temperatures, otherwise even for HA Q heat equation, if you know the surface, if you don't know the temperature, how can you find? So for any equation, they will give you the temperature, surface temperature. So in academic purpose, for the problems and all, they will definitely give you the surface temperature and the ambient temperature so that you can find it out. But in experiments, you have to measure that. You may be giving the constant heat flux and you only the temperature is there, but how much heat you are taking out from the natural convection process, if at all you want to find out, you definitely need to know the temperatures along the surface of the plate. All right. So academic activity, they will give you they will mention the temperature. Experiment, you have to put thermocouples and measure at the temperature at the center part, and then you found out. And the experimentalist who has actually done many experiments, they might have checked with taking the temperature, the maximum temperature, which comes to at the top layer, at the top of the plate. There they might have used it, and at the bottom, and then they might have done so many juggleries, and after that only they gave a conclusion that at the center, if you take, it is more or less erroneous, error-free. It's less error we can get by using the same equations. Otherwise, they won't give you that. Clear? Okay. Next thing is, like, if you use a vertical cylinder. So if at all the vertical cylinder, if you use, if the vertical cylinder is sufficiently having a larger diameter, then the curvature will become, it's not varying so high. So in such a case, we can approximate it to be somewhat closer to a flat plate case. So we need a constraint to understand or to know that when can we consider that to be a long when can we consider that cylinder to be equivalent to a flat plate or vertical plate. For that we have given a constraint in equation number is not given in the next slide. Whichever I am showing, vertical cylinder case, they have given the diameter of the cylinder. It should be greater than or equal to 35 times the L by Grashof number, which is based on the length of the plate, whole power 1 by 4. So you can see here, there is a Grashof number, which is based on length L. That means length of the cylinder, whole power 1 by 4. And if the diameter is greater or equal to this value, then we can use 9.21. For actually calculating the Nusselt number. So the question is, immediate question is, sir, what about when the diameter is lesser than that? For that also we have some correlation given by Sebesi and all. So those are not in the academic purpose, they are not used extensively. So generally for simplification, if a cylinder is there, we can approximate it to be, we'll find out the diameter, and if it is approximating the flat plate, then we will directly go to that equation and use it. Okay, so that is basically your vertical case. Now, there is another case where we have an inclined plate consideration. So, what if the plate is in the inclined plate, inclined inclination? It is making an angle of theta with the inclination. So, you can see here in the figure, the slide number 17, you can see there that the x direction is all along the plate, along the surface of the plate. And y is perpendicular to the surface of the plate, and in the vertical direction, so always the flow will act in the upward direction. So suppose if you are having an inclination the orientation is an inclined, it's not equal 0 or 90 degrees or in between 0 to 90 degrees, and in such a case, suppose if the plate we are considering to be hot and we are keeping it in a very cold environment, the convection currents, since the flow is in the vertical direction, but the flow will take place in the two directions, because it doesn't have, it will have some component to flow along the plate also. So it can be resolved into fx and fy direction. So it is not same as the f, that we, the same as force as f. So we tend to think that in an inclined position, the flow, the heat transfer rate or Nusselt number will reduce compared to the orientation when it is in the vertical orientation. There is the continuous flow. The flow takes place around 90 degrees straight away along the plate. But here, it has to flow in this direction as well as it has to move up. So in these two considerations, the force is not the same that we see in the vertical plate configuration. Therefore, we tend to think that there will be a lesser Nusselt number case in when the plate is inclined. But to our surprise, that's not true. That's partially true, because this conclusion is true when an inclined surface only with the bottom surface is, when the bottom side surface is hot. If the bottom surface is hot and top surface is at the room temperature, only the bottom surface is hot, then what happens? There is the fx will keep on driving the flow here in this direction rather than fi direction, because the plate will actually opposing the force curve, fi component. Therefore, the force in the y direction component is actually being obstructed by the flow. Therefore, there is a constant boundary layer that goes, and the boundary layer thickness keeps on increasing. So the conclusion that we gave, that the heat transfer rate is lower in case of an inclined plate compared to a vertical plate, is true when the heating side is in the bottom, when the heater is in the bottom side. But to our surprise, when the heater is on the top side, what happens is that the force, even though there is an x component which drives the flow along the plate, always the force which is in the vertical direction dominates, and what it will does is it forms like plumes, like small jets kind of a thing. So you can see from the figure, small boundary growth, and then it moves up, and again there is a small boundary growth. So because of this, thickness of the boundary layer is so small that it's forming on the top of the plate, we always tend to have higher heat transfer rate compared to the vertical heated plate. So in such a case, so this is the vertical orientation cases. So these are the two things that we can observe from this particular thing. So it is always advisable to keep the hotter side whenever we want to put it in an inclination. It is always advisable that the hot side of the plate is facing the top. That means it is open to the sky, towards the sky. And it is, if we want to reduce the heat transfer, then we can put it in the bottom side. So that is one thing. So now coming for the equation, depending on the theta and all, use vertical equation for the upper side and the lower surface offset. So here the equations. I think I missed the equations. I keep the equations here and send you. So we have these equations. So what you need to do is, wherever g is there, we have to g cos theta, and then based on the angles. So this equation is true for upper surface of a cold plate and the lower surface of a hot plate. For this particular correlations, I'll keep it and give you. But the physics behind that is this. Okay. Just give me 1 second. I'll just check whether I forgot to do this. So here it was simply mentioned that we can use the vertical plate configuration to calculate the Nusselt number. The same equation here we can use. Only thing is, this equation we can put g cos theta instead of g. Wherever g we will get, we will put g cos theta, and the theta should be less than or equal to in between 0 to 60 degrees angle, in between that angle. And primarily it is for measuring the upper surface. Use vertical plate equation for the upper surface of a cold plate and the lower surface of a hot plate. So we are using this equation, same vertical equation, when we have a deterioration kind of a heat transfer. We are not using it for increased heat transfer case. So when you have an upper surface of a cold plate and the lower surface of a hot plate, that means whenever you are going to deteriorate, the heat transfer will just be lesser than the vertical plate case. In that case, you can put G instead of G, you replace it by G cos theta when the given angle of inclination is theta. For the other case, I'll try to find you and give you that other case. I missed it somewhere. Okay. So that is basically your inclined plate. Now coming to an interesting thing is basically your horizontal plates. So when you are using your horizontal plate, you can see that when the hot side is on the top, you always tend to have higher heat transfer rate because there is no obstruction to the buoyancy force of the convection currents created by the buoyancy force. They generally move up with rapidity, so the convection currents are strong, so that there will be higher heat transfer rate in this direction. But when you keep the heating side on the bottom, you imagine what will happen. The natural convection currents cannot move very, the motion of this natural convection currents will be impeded by this for this hot plate, and they have to move towards their edges and then move upward. So because of this, what happens, the bottom surface, which is always needed to be in contact with the cold surface, so suppose if the fluid is coming over here and it gets heated up and it moves all along it, automatically the temperature difference is lower, and therefore you'll have a lesser Nusselt number value. So if at all you want to use a if you want to horizontal orientation for natural convection, the best bet to increase the heat transfer rate is keep your hot side on the top, not at the bottom. If you are keeping the hot side at the bottom, you tend to have very less heat transfer rate. You cannot have the better of the two. So we have correlations for both of them. So for a horizontal plate, we have the correlations. You can see that in the first A, if we have a surface area A and perimeter P, and it's a plate, where A is the case where upper surface of a hot plate, and you can also think this other way around is, suppose if it is colder than the environment case. In such a case, the cold side should be kept at the bottom so that it will not impeded by the plate. So the convection currents will be strong enough to move downward direction. But if you keep the cold side on the top, what happens? The flow tries to move downwards, but the plate will impede the flow. So the two things are basically, the favorable things are, if you want to heat it, if you want to cool the body, keep the hot surface on the top. If you want to heat the body, keep the cold surface on the bottom. So that is the bottom line. So here we have correlations for those two favorable cases. One is upper surface of a hot plate or lower surface of a cold plate. That means if you want to cool the plate, with higher efficiency, or if you want to heat the plate with higher efficiency by natural convection, for a Reynolds number of 10 power 7, less than 10 power 7, we use this 9.22 correlation, 0.54 into Rayleigh number 1 by 4. Similarly, for a turbulent flow, you use 0.15 into Rayleigh power 1 by 3. This is C into Ra power n, same values. We are using like this. Suppose if you are going the other way, where you are trying to keep the lower surface of the hot plate and upper surface of the cold plate, this is the unfavorable conditions. So in this, for a whole range, 10 power 5 to 10 power 11, you can see that the Nusselt number is 0.27 into RAL into 1 by 4. But the interesting part here is, for all other plates, we have taken the characteristic length to be L here, whereas in this plate, for the horizontal plate configurations, to calculate Rayleigh number or Grashof number, the characteristic length, the LC, for calculating the Grashof number, Grashof number is given by Z beta delta T L cube by nu square. So in the place L, you cannot use the length of the plate as we have used in the vertical or inclined surface. We have to calculate the surface area by the perimeter. And this value, we will keep it in the Grashof number to calculate the Rayleigh number, and then we will use it in the Nusselt number equation. So for the favorable conditions, we will use the two above equations, and for the weaker heat transfer configurations, we will use the 9.24 equation. So one, these are all about the plates which are in horizontal, vertical, and inclined positions. And cylinder.
Sir, why does the U shape of current occur?
So why does that?
Why does the current occur in a U shape?
So everywhere, no. You can think that the temperature is higher, right? Everywhere, and somewhere the you are only looking at the from the this particular point of view. But in the other side, the cold air will come, right? In contact with it, it gets heated up. So there will be always the circulation kind of a thing that will be happening. So because of that, you will kind of motion which is going out, and there is on the from the other side, perpendicular to that, from the lateral side, the air will come and cool down, and it will be keeping on moving it up. So you are seeing that.
Okay.
So now the next case is horizontal cylinders and spheres. Suppose if the cylinder is not in the vertical condition and it is in the sphere, if they both are in the in this particular case, and if they are the surface temperature is higher than the environment, you can see that the flow will start from the bottom. Here from the bottom it will start. It will move like this, so that we can see so two boundary layers which are forming all over the surface, just like flow over a cylinder in the fluid dynamics case. We can see that it goes on and it will move like this. But you may get the question, why doesn't the flow, I mean, the flow separation will not take place or what? Because in a natural convection case, the flow rates are very, very low. So we can tend to understand that the Reynolds numbers are pretty low in a natural convection case. So we don't see any separation from this particular hot cylinder case. So what we can observe from this is the boundary layer is very thin all along the plate at the bottom, and it becomes thicker and higher at the rear end. So you can always think that the Nusselt number value will be highest here and the lowest at the top. Similarly, the case will be opposite for if the body is cold, then the same flow will, we can see in the opposite direction. The flow will start here and it will go on going like this in the opposite direction. You have to tilt the figure by almost 180 degrees, then we can see that. Okay, so in the same case also, in the colder condition case, you can observe that the top surface will have the higher Nusselt number and the bottom surface will have the lower Nusselt. Okay, so similar explanation we can give for a sphere case. They don't change much. So for a horizontal cylinders, we have the equation when we use the diameters. We have similar correlations given here in table 9.1, and we can straight away use those equations and get the Nusselt number values. Okay, so now this is all about, you can, whatever we can think of, this is all our really related to the external flows, external natural convection flow. And there are certain applications where we use the internal natural convection also, which may be to promote or to actually arrest the heat transfer as an insulator. So we have certain applications where we does that. So in order to find out what happens if the flow is inside, internal, if the flow is flowing inside. So that part we are looking at now. So we are thinking that this particular case is basically observed when there are fins or extended surfaces as heat sink over the PCBs and all. So on the chips and all, if you want to take out heat from that, now you know that electronic cooling requirement. So there is a lot of heat that is being coming out. There is a lot of heat flux around 300 watt per centimeter square right now, which is almost equal to the sun's surface. So that much amount of heat flux per meter square, you are getting that much. So so that much of amount of heat in a very, very small area, you have to take it out. So initially when they started, they were thinking of doing that by means of natural convection, and later the fluxes have gone too high, so people have to come up with new solutions and all. But natural convection in those cases, why they preferred is basically you don't need any pumps or anything, so that you don't need to you need to don't need to look out for the vibrational problems and all that, so failures and all, we don't need it. Everything happens by on its own. So initially for the laptop cooling and all, they didn't use this fan system and all, forced convection system. They just gone through with the natural convection cases only by giving it just a heat sink. So in a heat sink, what happens, the fins, which are of different configurations, they will be spaced. So if you can say, you can see that if the spacing is pretty close and it is of sufficient length, then we can solve this. This is S, capital S is nothing but the distance between the two fins, where S is very much greater than the thickness of each fin. That is our assumption. So if that happens, so this is the surface, bottom surface, and you can see there is a flow that is coming from the bottom, from in the lateral directions. You don't think that from the bottom means there is a solid surface, is there, how it is. From the other sides, from the lateral surfaces, the air will come, it gets heated up, and when it is moving, the other air from the lateral side will come. So the flow will form a boundary layer, and if the length of the pipes are sufficiently large, then we do have a merging of this and a fully developed boundary condition, fully developed natural convection channel flow will come. So we will solve this as a fully developed channel flow case. Okay, so once it becomes fully developed, we know that the value becomes constant. The Nusselt number values, you don't need to calculate at all. Just like in the forced convection case, once they become fully developed, so whatever the velocities you give, it will not change. The Nusselt number will remain 4.33 and 3.66 for constant heat flux and constant temperature conditions. So there's nothing much about, there is nothing you can do much about it. So we will solve this if the sufficiently higher and it forms like a fully developed channel flow, we will solve that analytical solution and we will use that for heat transfer. Suppose if the lengths are not so high and they're distinct, the S is different, I mean, much away from each other. So there may be, this matching may not be seen. In such a case, we will use the vertical plate equation and try to find out the Nusselt number for this particular thing. So in a case where they are very close and forms a merging of the boundary layer, we will solve it by fully developed inner pipe kind of a flow. So that we will solve in that way. Okay. So this kind of an arrangement we can see in heat sinks with, see, you can see in the figure here A and B, you can see here. So there are widely spaced and they are very closely spaced. So what happens when we put this in a widely spaced condition? So when you keep each fin away from or taking a long distance, so what happens is the surface area to cool down gets higher, but the velocities with which the amount of flow passing, that means the heat transfer coefficient will not be so high. A will be higher, H will be lesser, so your Q will not be so high. In the other case, when the fins are very close to each other, in the case like B, we can see that in this particular case, what happens? The surface area is lower, A will be lower, but sorry, I told them the other way. When the plates are widely spaced, you will have higher H, higher heat transfer coefficient, but surface area will be lower. Okay, so you will have a lower one value increasing, other value decreasing. So you will have a one value of Q. We don't know whether it's higher or lower. But in the other case, what happens when the fins are very close? Your surface area is increasing, but your heat transfer coefficient is decreasing because these closely packed fins, it will not allow the flow to pass through. It will create a lot of pressure drop. So because of that, there will be not enough amount of air that goes inside and pulls that heat out. So again, here the H will be lower and A will be higher. So in this case also, we don't know how the heat transfer will link. So in these two cases, there is a conflict between H and A. So always when there is a conflicting between two parameters, when we have an objective function, then obviously we can go for an optimum spacing. So what is the optimum space where we can have a maximized value? So for that particular case, they have gone for when natural convection on finite surfaces with temperature as constant. So these cases we can take in two ways. One with the constant heat flux case or one with constant temperature case. Suppose you are taking the rally number. So here the rally number is based on the spacing of between the fins. So they define for this kind of finite problems and PCBs problems, what they take the characteristic length is, the characteristic length they will take or they will choose is not the length of the plate, but the spacing between two fins. Yes, that is the spacing that they will take. And based on that, they have defined the rally number based on yes. So similarly, if you want to calculate the normal rally number, you will multiply that with L cube by S cube, where L is the fin height. What is the height of this is fin height, and S is the fin spacing. So when TS is constant, we will use this particular equation, 576. This is the equation that we use for Nusselt number, which is vertical isothermal parallel plates. This equation we can use, which is nothing but 576 by RAS into S by L square plus 2.873 RAS into S by L whole power 0.5 to the power of minus 0.5. So this is the generalized equation. So for any number, for whatever be the spacing between the plates, we can use this particular equation to find the Nusselt number. But what we require is, we want to have an optimum spacing where the heat transfer rate it will become higher. So we need to find out what is S optimum. So if we can find out what is, if we can find an S optimum, thus S optimum, if we keep it in the S place, so then we will get the Nusselt number to be maximum. So in for that case, we have an optimum equation here, S optimum equation. This will help you to, when you put these values into this, we will get what is the optimum spacing we need to give between two parallel fins, where the width of the plate is W, the height of the fins are H, and the length of the fins are L. So in such a configuration, what is the specific, and the thickness of the fin is T, and spacing between the fins is capital S. In such a case, and they are vertically oriented, in such a case, the optimum value, thinking that the boundary condition everywhere the surface temperature is constant, in that particular case, we can use the optimum condition 2.714 S cube L by RAS. So once you simplify this, you will be left over with this expression, 2.714 L by RAL whole power 0.25. So when we use this, you get an expression, Nusselt number equal to 1.0307. That is the value that you are getting for optimum spacing, this Nusselt number value. So if you are trying to find out what is the heat transfer rate, then you know the Nusselt number. From this, you will find out the H and find out the number of, you need to find out the surface area, which will be calculated by the N is the number of fins into the L into H, you will get the surface area into TS minus T infinity. That will give you the heat transfer rate over here. So for a TS constant, S optimum we need to find out, and when you put the S optimum into this equation, this is 1.37 for a particular case. Suppose if you are not using a S optimum, if you want to find out the Nusselt number between any spacing, you can use this equation and find out the values for the Nusselt number. Okay, so this is basically your heat transfer rate calculation, basically with the number of fins, when small n is the number of fins and the other, the surface area is followed by this equation, we got this. So here also we follow the rule that the properties which are required to be put in the equation, they will be calculated at the film temperature. Similarly, we have vertical PCBs. In the vertical PCBs, what happens, ideal fin, all over the surface, correct. Other fins, let me finish this part, then we will discuss. Let me finish, because some more is there, the flow will be missing. So let me finish that, and we'll take time and we'll discuss that. Okay, right. So the natural convection cooling of a vertical PCB. Here, the vertical PCB is basically not a particular surface. We will have chips on the printed circuit board. So everywhere there is will be some heat flux, and there will be, we will have a different temperatures all around the surfaces. So here you are taking the spacing between the PCBs as S, and height and all other geometric configurations they have given. So here also the same thing, you will calculate the Rayleigh number based on the spacing of the fins, and then we will go to Nusselt number. You will calculate by this equation, and here also we are assuming that QS is constant. So the same thing here, you are assuming that the heat transfer coefficient is heat flux is constant, and for that we have an equation for finding out the optimum value. So when we want to find out the optimum value, this is the equation we need to find out for a given L and for a given Rayleigh number. We need to find out what is the optimum value, and that value when you put, you will get the Nusselt number. Similarly, you can find out the heat transfer rate over here, exactly equivalent to the properties has to be taken in the same way. Coming for inside enclosures, natural convection inside enclosures. So natural convection inside enclosures. So first we'll understand why do we need to use this. So generally sometimes we want to actually arrest the amount of heat that is being dissipated out of a body. And at the same time we may require to be the insulating material to be transparent also. So in such a cases what we do is we will keep one glass, and in between those two pane glasses, in between them we have some certain amount of air, because air has a very low thermal conductivity, so it acts as, and it is transparent too. So therefore we want to keep the double pane in the cold countries where they want to keep the heat, room heat, they will use this double pane windows so that the heat will not transfer to the outside very fastly. So they want to use such a case. So that is one of the application, and we do have other applications also. In such a case where there is this two surfaces and between the air is entrapped, that means from other sides we are not allowing any flow. So all the four sides being are entrapped, it's closed. So in the other cases what we have seen, there is other sides are open, only two plates are there. The other sides you have openings, so the cold air comes from that side. So that is basically for enhancing the heat transfer or increasing the heat transfer rate. But here is a case where we are actually closing the four sides with two panes, and in between there is the air that is being trapped. So in such a case, if a vertical pane, as we have shown in this figure, is there, one side you are keeping it hot and the other side you are keeping it cold, then what happens, the cold surface is heavy, it becomes heavier, so it goes down, and then the other side which is hot, it goes up. So you can see a circulation that is happening in this direction. It will rotate like this. Okay, initially when the Rayleigh number is less than 1708, when up to this we cannot see any currents that is being formed. So the critical number where actual current starts to move is, you calculate the Rayleigh number. If the Rayleigh number is greater than 1708, so then you can see that there will be a rotation inside the, we can see the natural convection current which is moving inside that. Okay, similarly if Rayleigh number is greater than 3 × 10⁵, then obviously we will have a turbulent fluid motion. In the other case where external flows, you can, we have the Rayleigh number greater than 10⁹ is a turbulent case. But here within 3 × 10⁵ itself we can find a turbulent boundary condition. So this is for a vertical double pane configuration where we need to find out how the circulations will happen. Suppose if the same pane plate is in the horizontal condition, and if the hot plate is on the top and bottom plate is in the bottom, cold plate is on the bottom side. So imagine here in this particular case, the hot side which is actually heating the air very close to it, so there will not be any motion downwards. The flow with the amount of air inside, it will be stable. It will not be unstable. It will be stable. So it will not go up. It cannot go up. So it will remain the same. So whatever the heat transfer that is happening, that happens because of the conduction process. So there is no fluid motion over here. So there is no circulation that starts. So there is a consistent amount of heat transfer that takes place by convection. Therefore, we always get the Nusselt number to be 1. Okay, so there is a other condition where the hot body is at the bottom and the cold body is at the top. The other sides are closed and the air is entrapped in between. See here, the four sides are closed. No air that can come in and go out. Only air is entrapped. So the similar case over here, where you have a hot plate and cold plate at the bottom and top respectively, then you can see that the hot air, it tries to move up, and the surrounding cold air, it tries to come down. So with that, what they will have, they will form kind of small vertices within that, which is called as Bernard cells. So this is called as Bernard cells. It's not like the motion is not like, it will not happen like this. It will form small circulations within the spacing itself. After proper steady state it reaches, it will form small cells to increase the heat transfer. So natural convection happens in small cavities in this way, in this particular way. So how to calculate this, how to calculate the how to analyze this particular case? If you can see here, this particular case, we can write the equations for thermal conductivity as Q equal to, we know that convection, Newton's law of cooling, HA delta T. In the similar way, you can, when H, basically Nusselt number is HL by K. So if you replace H by Nusselt number and the other terms, you will get K into NU by LC. So if you look at this equation looks like, if K into NU, if you are taking as thermal conductivity, some K A dT by dx. Okay, so it becomes the Fourier kind of an equation. So we have two terms over here than one term. So instead of one particular term where we are using it as a conduction, we have an extra term K into NU. If we can take that as K effective, we consider that to be as K effective. K effective equal to K into NU. So if you can have this value, you can solve this as a conduction problem. Okay. Similarly, what happens if we have a horizontal rectangular enclosures? So you have a horizontal rectangular enclosures, and there is always how much width between the spacing. What is the width between these two plates? Based on that, the amount of circulations, the formation of circulations, everything will change. So here what we use is, we have two correlations, CRA power N kind of a thing only. So for horizontal enclosures that contain air, these relations can be used for other gases with 0.5 Prandtl number. When it is in between 0.5 and 2, we can use this equation. This is for laminar and this is for turbulent, we can use. And for water, silicon and mercury, you can use this correlation for finding out the values. Okay. And we have another equation. So suppose if this equation for Rayleigh number is less than 10 power 8, if we are want to use this expression, so when this plus terms, bracket plus terms, if they become negative, we will consider it to be zero and we don't use them. These should be considered only when they become positive. 1 minus 1708 by RAL, if this term becomes a negative, we will consider this to be zero and this term is knocked out. And RAL by 18 power 1 by 3, if this term becomes zero, then or negative, then we consider this term to be zero and only one will be there. So only for positive terminologies in the brackets which are having plus values, we will consider this. Otherwise, we will forget. We will not use this equations. And as I told you, isothermal surfaces with hot surface at the top, we always have NU equal to 1. So we also have the equations for enclosures, inclined and right rectangular enclosures, where you have the different equations for using based on your theta. What is the angle of theta? Based on that, we also have other consideration. What is my H by L? So this is the aspect ratio. H is the height of the plate and L is the width of the plate. Width bit are different, not width, it's distance between the two plates or the spacing between the two plates. So for different H by L ratios, for different critical angles, we can use the above correlations here. The generalized correlation is the top one, which is in the red, This can be used h by l is greater than 12, greater than or equal to 12, theta is in between 0 to 70 degrees and Rayleigh number is less than 10 power 5, you can safely use this equation. Suppose if the h by l value is lesser than 12, so this value, even smaller kind of a thing if it is, so the height is very much lower, then what we use, we will use this equation. Similarly, for vertical equations, we have the same. We have correlations for based on the configuration h by l. We have different values. You can have a look at it. The important thing is we need to calculate all these values at the film temperature. All the properties we have to take at the film temperature. So these equations are straightforward. So I'm not spending much time on that. So whatever the value you can took h by value based on the h by l value and quantum numbers, each equation you can use. So there are four equations based on what is given in your data book, and accordingly you can use that. So one thing is, like, these are taken from a textbook where most of the important prominent data they might be giving, but in the data book you may not find it. So don't worry. So whatever the formula that is available, you please use that formula. Similarly, there are applications where we have concentric cylinders. So there is a heat transfer, there is air that is inside this annular space we may have. Thus, in such a case, we have a shape factor to be found out. So you can find out based on these diameters, we have a geometric factor called F cylinder. So if you find out this based on the diameter, inner and outer diameter and the length of the plate, so this we can use in the equations. So you can find out that for concentric cylinders, F cylinder into Rayleigh number is less than 100, natural convection currents are negligible and you don't need to use them. So K effective and K will become the same. So first you need to find out what is the effective K from this. So effective K, if you want to find out, you need to understand what is F cylinder. So the geometric factors of the cylinder you need to find out. That we will use here and find out what is the K effective. And once you find out the effective thermal conductivity, you will put it over here and find the heat flux, heat transfer rate. So K effective, if you want to know, you need to know the F cylinder, and that means geometric factor of the cylinder. That will be calculated based on the inner and outer diameter and length of the plate. That is the essence of this particular thing. So, so LC over here, this will be used based on D naught minus DI by 2. So all others are here. All others are here. So for trick factor into Rayleigh number is less than 100, these are negligible, and therefore this will be value will become very, very low when it is less than 100. So K effective will become A. Yeah, K itself. Note that K cannot be less than K, and that we should, so always we use K effective as K, and other properties are same. Similarly, for concentric spheres, when there is a concentric sphere, similarly we need to find out the geometric factor for the sphere using the inner diameter and outer diameter and the characteristic length. And this value we will use into the K effective by K equation. Find out the K effective, and from the K effective you will find out the heat transfer rate from this equation. Suppose if K effective by K becomes equivalent to less than 1, even in this case we will not take K effective to be less than K, but instead we will take K effective is equivalent to K. So up to this we have the natural convection cases. So almost all the problems, almost everything we have covered it up in this particular thing. So let us go to the summary, what we have touched upon. The summary is basically your physical mechanism of natural convection, what are the mechanisms involved, equations of motion and Kirchhoff number we have converted, and then we have found out for external convection, natural convection case, where vertical plate, vertical cylinder, inclined plate, horizontal cylinder and sphere, and then film surfaces and PCBs also we have touched upon, and then we have inside enclosures, wherever the inside flow we are trying to define what is the effective thermal conductivity for a horizontal, inclined, vertical thing, concentric cylinders and concentric spheres we have solved. So what I will do is, one second, let me finish. What I will do is, I'll try to formulate some problems or take some problems and post it to you. So you meanwhile you try to solve them, and I'll also send the answers along with them. So if at all you have any doubts in that, we will discuss in the next class. Okay. So let's take some of the questions. Yeah, you can go on.
Yeah.
Okay. Correct. Okay, you're asking me that if there is temperature difference along the fin, how do we deal with it? That's what you're asking, right? So such cases, basically, you are using constant heat flux. We have now apart from the ideal fin condition, all other cases we have a temperature gradient all along the fin, right? So unless you have K effective very high, we always have the we are using the basic conditions when we put the end conditions to be insulated and all. There we are not assuming the fin surface to be constant. It is varying. It's varying. So whatever we are calculating for the heat transfer, that is basically with different temperatures only. So I didn't understand what exactly you're asking. So you are no, surface temperature is constant. Okay, for this particular case. No. We have to take the average of it. There is no other way. So whatever we are keeping on, we will take the average temperature of it. Just like the constant heat flux case, whatever we are taking. Similarly, we have to take the average value of the surface temperature. There's nothing that we can do. We have to keep, if it is an experimental thing, we have to keep the thermocouples at different locations, take the average. That becomes your surface temperature. Not only for this, for any experimental thing, if where there is a temperature gradient, if it's not very high, then what we will do is you will keep the number of thermocouples, record the temperatures with respect to time, and every time you take the average and you say that the average temperature is varying like this. You cannot say pinpointedly at this location what is happening every time. You may plot it and show in an Excel file. That's fine. But as a problem, when you are solving, where you need to have the average temperature. For heat transfer rate, you need the average surface temperature. So obviously, the temperatures will not be uniform everywhere. For generally for experiments, what we do, we give a heater, resistance heater or something we use. So the resistance heater only gives constant heat flux. So the temperatures are not the same. So simply what we do, we will put thermocouples, take the record them in the data acquisition system, and then take the average with respect to time. So that's how we will do it. Yeah. And any other?
Sir, what are we using these enclosures for? Because sir, according to this, when we use an enclosure, the heat transfer is increasing.
It will not increase. See, initially when they started it, what happens is they wanted it to be absolutely lesser value, right?
Yes, sir.
So they don't want the heat to go out. They don't want to eat the heat to move out. So what they thought initially, if you keep air inside two planes or glasses with all the sides closed, so there will not be any initial movement of the fluid. So that will happen only by conduction. Since the air is having very, very low thermal conductivity, the heat transfer will lower. But instead, what is happening, if the spacing between those two planes, that value is not optimum, then what happens, as you said, there will be more heat transfer. The Nusselt number will be greater than 1. That means it is more than conduction.
Okay.
Okay. So that therefore the studies are required to understand that where can we make that the circulations we will try to neglect the circulations. We don't want that natural convection to happen. So if it is a insulation kind of a thing, we try to make sure that there is no internal Bernard circulations to happen. So we will keep them more distance apart so that the circulations will not happen. Okay, so it's okay. Just a play. So ideal case, we thought that there will not be any heat transfer. But what is happening is there is a heat transfer by natural convection still. So because of the convection, because of the circulations, there is a heat transfer that is happening. So the heat is going out of the room, a hot room, the hot temperatures inside the room is going out. So they played with the optimized cases, how much spacing we should give. So when we increase the spacing, the circulations will go down. It will kind of rotate like that from the bottom to the top. So what is the optimum spacing is between those studies will be there. So this is basically to make sure that the essential thing is for a insulator, we need to make sure that circulations are less. There is no natural circulation cases, but it tend to happen when the Rayleigh number goes greater than 1708. For the particular cases, so obviously the circulations will start. Clear? The idea is that, but it is not thing. But however, it is lesser than the forced convection case. Or if you keep just a wall and all, they will have higher metals or glasses or ceramics. They will have higher thermal conductivity than air. Therefore, when compared with them, air within the glass panes will be more. Kind of more better insulator. That is the point.
Okay.
Yeah. Any others? Anyone? So this questions are same. So the formulas that we have, they are all in the data book. So we will make sure that I'll ask Raju also to, when we formulate the question paper, we will sit with the data book, and whichever data book we are all following the same data book. So we'll make sure that questions will come from there. Even if by mistake that something happens if the mistake is from our side, we will avoid the marks. Don't worry about the marks. Just take this time to understand why we are using the formulas. Okay, Ganesh, if no questions are there, then I'll try to end the session. So what I'll do is I'll post you the assignment kind of a thing with answers and as well as questions. Mostly, I hope you can solve them. If not, we will take some time, half an hour or so, we'll solving those problems in the next class or doubts and all. And then we will start with the heat exchangers next class. Okay, so I hope everyone is fine. So what is the strength today? 26, huh? Or someone left already. 26 is the maximum strength. So total 30 we are getting out of 70. That's okay. If it is not less than 10, then it's fine. Some I'll be able to teach. So okay, so take care all of you. Bye.